The world-renowned Mormon Tabernacle Choir celebrates this holiday season with a Christmas concert featuring Broadway star Sutton Foster and renowned British actor Hugh Bonneville.
Once a year and every year we try to find a gift, a turtle dove, a golden ring to mend that little rift. But when the pretty bows are tossed and wrapping paper flies, it's not the gift that melts our hearts, it's how the giver tries. Oh, Christmas, Christmas, you have a wondrous power to call our better angels forth until our demons cower. Yes, Christmas, Christmas, though carols fade away, your spirit makes the whole merry old Christmas Day.
Once a year and every year, our door is open wide to all of you who double-crossed and cheated us and lied, who pinched our candy, skimmed our cream, yet lacking any gall. Sing fa-la-la so cheerfully, we must forgive it all.
Oh, Christmas, Christmas, you have a wondrous heart. So call the bells and rings as well for two my dreams come. Yes, Christmas, Christmas, the carols fade away. The spirit makes the whole of life a merry on Christmas Day.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tony Award-winning star of stage and television, Sutton Foster.
Kids friends come to call. It's the happiest season of all. There'll be parties for hosting, marshmallows for toasting, and caroling out in the snow. There'll be scary ghost stories and tales of the glories of Christmases long, long ago. Wonderful time of the year. There'll be much mistletoeing and hearts will be glowing when loved ones are near. It's the most wonderful time. It's the most wonderful time. It's the most I cannot tell you how thrilled I am to be here. Thank you, Mac and Ryan and everyone in this incredible choir and this orchestra for giving me the chance to perform with them tonight. One thing to know about me is that I love Christmas because it makes me feel like a kid again. It makes the world young and fresh and beautiful. And one of my favorite things to do at Christmas is watch the Charlie Brown special. I watch it and I dance like Pigpen and I sing along and I tear up when Linus gives his sermon and all the kids trim Charlie's tiny tree. Now this Christmas, I feel especially like a kid because it's my first one with a child of my own. Recently, my husband and I adopted a newborn baby girl, Emily Dale Griffin. So I cannot wait to show her a Charlie Brown Christmas and to someday sing the song along with her. Christmas time is here. And cheer, fun for all the children call their favorite time of year. Snowflakes in the air, carols everywhere, olden times and ancient rhymes of love and dreams to share. And hair with snow. A quilt of snow. What is Christmas with no snow? No white Christmas with no snow. I'll soon be there with snow.
I'll wash my hair with snow. And with the spade of snow.
Love to stay up with you, but I recommend a little should I go to sleep and dream of snow. Yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. From now on, our troubles will be out of sight. Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Make the Yuletide gay. From now on, our troubles will be miles away. Here we are as in olden days, happy golden days of yore. Faithful once more. Through the years, we all will be together if the fates allow. Hang a shining star. Yourself a merry little Christmas now. Happy holiday, happy holiday, while the merry bells keep ringing. Happy holiday. Is coming round. The Christmas snow is white on the ground. When old Santa gets into town, he'll be coming down the chimney down.
He'll be coming down the chimney down.
It's the holiday season.
Holiday season.
And Santa Claus has got a toy for every good girl and good little boy. Santa's a great big bundle of joy when he's coming down the chimney down. Lots of goodies for you and for me. So leave a peppermint stick for old Saint Nick hanging around the Christmas tree. It's the holiday season.
Holiday season.
So hoop-dee-doo and dickery-dock. And don't forget to hang out your sock, 'cause just exactly at 12 o'clock he'll be coming down the chimney, coming down the chimney, yeah.
Please welcome acclaimed film and television actor, Hugh Bonneville.
Thank you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for that warm welcome. Christmas is, of course, a time for celebrating new birth. It's a time for family, for giving. And in my house, anyway, we always raise a toast to absent friends, to those we have lost. And we share stories about them, bringing them back to life in our memory. And the account I want to share with you this Christmas season is just such a story. It's about a family who, in the darkest moments of life, found the hope and peace we associate with this season, the true spirit of Christmas, how it transformed them and also has blessed this world. In mid-November 1873, an ocean liner, the Ville de Havre, set sail from New York bound for France with 313 passengers on board. One can imagine their festive Atlantic crossing with ribbons of red, swags of evergreen, and Christmas carols wafting through a dining room sparkling with candlelight. In a few days, they would make landfall in Europe, just in time for Christmas in Paris. Anna Spafford and her four little girls were among the delighted passengers. They had come from Chicago. Annie, aged 11, Margaret Lee, 9, Bessie, 5, and little Tanetta, aged 2. Their father, Horatio, had intended to sail with them, but was detained on business. Not to worry, he assured his wife and children. He would book his passage in a few days, and soon they would be reunited in Paris, the city of light, celebrating the season of goodwill. And goodwill is what they needed. 2 years earlier, the great Chicago fire had all but destroyed Horatio's business interests. So this journey was intended to restore hope and bring healing into their lives. Once on board the ship on the evening of November the 22nd, Anna and her girls knelt down, said their prayers, and fell asleep, dreaming of the Yuletide festivities to come. But at about 2 o'clock in the morning, they were suddenly jolted awake in their berths. Despite a clear, starry sky, the Ville de Havre had inexplicably collided with the Loch Hearn, an iron-hulled Scottish clipper. Lifeboats quickly filled with people. Many passengers leapt into the icy waters. Anna tried desperately to keep her children together, but the two eldest became separated in the confusion. Just 12 minutes after the impact, a wave washed over the deck, and Anna was drawn under, together with her two youngest daughters. She held on to 5-year-old Bessie until her strength gave out. Her last memory was of 2-year-old Tanetta in her lace nightgown, torn from her grasp, getting smaller and smaller, until she too finally disappeared. Later, the crew of the Loch Hearn found Anna unconscious, floating on a wooden plank. When the ship docked in Wales, Anna sent a telegram to her husband. It read, "Saved alone. What shall I do?" Horatio immediately sailed from New York. He wrote to a friend, "There is just one thing in these days that has become magnificently clear. I must not lose faith." 4 days into his voyage, on a Thursday evening, the captain summoned Mr. Spafford to the foredeck. By the crew's calculations, they were nearing the very place where Anna's ship had gone down, taking with it their 4 daughters, now resting some 3 miles below. But Horatio refused to look down. "I did not think of our dear ones there," he later recounted. Instead, he gazed out across the rolling waves and up into moonlit sky. There and then, he began to formulate a simple expression of his faith, a verse that would become a hymn. "When peace, like a river, attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well. It is well with my soul." Only a few weeks earlier, in the same place on the open sea, Anna had experienced a similar awakening. After her rescue, when she'd regained consciousness, she was overcome with despair and simply wanted to throw herself back into the ocean. What was life worth now? What could it ever be without her children? But then, it was as if she heard a voice in her mind and her heart. "You are spared for a purpose, Anna. You have a work to do." Once they had returned to Chicago, Horatio sought the support and prayers of his congregation to help him face the dire financial straits in which he found himself. Anna gave birth to a boy and then a girl. But sorrow upon sorrow, that son, Horatio Jr., succumbed to scarlet fever at the age of 3. Then, a year later, another daughter was born. Only 2 of their 7 children lived to maturity. But the Spaffords never yielded hope. Through that harrowing Christmas season of 1873, the Spaffords became even more certain that God loves all his children, whoever they are, and whatever tribulations they may suffer. In 1881, the family moved to Jerusalem and established there an American colony not far from the little town of Bethlehem we celebrate at Christmas. Although deeply religious, their purpose was not to proselytize, but to serve people of all backgrounds, relieving the effects of poverty, disease, and strife wherever it was found. 7 years later, Horatio himself died. Grieving once again, Anna Spafford had every reason to give up, but she did not. Every life has contradictions and imperfections, and hers was no exception. But when it mattered most, in her most profound spiritual crisis, when all seemed lost, Anna found the strength to move forward and to turn outward, to continue the work she and her husband had begun. And the seed of service which they had planted bore sweet fruit indeed. In time, their daughter Bertha expanded the Spaffords' humanitarian work with the simple intent of rescuing those who had experienced the shipwrecks of life as they had. During World War I, she led the way in organizing soup kitchens for refugees. She also oversaw hospitals for wounded soldiers on all sides of the conflict. One Christmas Eve, on her way to Bethlehem, Bertha met a Bedouin man, his ailing wife, and their newborn son traveling to Jerusalem by donkey. Later, Bertha wrote, "Here stood before me a rustic Madonna and babe, and similar to Mary's plight, there was no place for them to stay." By the next morning, the mother had died, and Bertha was asked to take care of the child. She agreed. She named the little boy Noel. And within the week, she had taken in 2 more orphaned babies. And so began the Spafford family's most enduring charitable work, a hospital for children. She explained, "We make no distinction in nationality or creed, the only requirement being that people absolutely need our help." And some of the Spaffords' charitable work continues to this day in the Children's Center that bears the family name.
Oh,
For nearly 150 years, millions have sung and have been lifted by Horatio's hymn, but most have not been aware of the circumstances in which it was written. But they have been strengthened by its universal message. Horatio's words echo with the story of Christmas. A child was born in Bethlehem, bringing peace on earth and goodwill toward men. Because of him and through his example, the human spirit can rise above tragedy. Whenever, however, we suffer our own night of sorrow, God's love does shine in the darkness. Hope can heal the wounded soul. And the Christmas work of giving, of loving, serving, and of rescuing is ours if we choose to make it so. And as we do, we join with saints and angels to rejoice and sing. It is well. It is well with my soul.
Thank you.
And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. Ye who sang creation's story, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Writer visions be.